Welcome to Medicine with Dr. Moran. Today I'm going to talk about an autopsy-based study from Germany. It looked at people who died suddenly and unexpectedly within 20 days after receiving a COVID-19 vaccination. This has just been published in Clinical Research in Cardiology, and as always, there's a link below to the study in the description. Now, what did these people die of? First, I want to give you some background. I've reported on numerous studies looking at myocarditis and pericarditis after vaccination on my channel. We know that the incidence of this seems to be on the order of about 1 in 5,000 in young males after the second vaccination with Moderna, but it's less common with other vaccines, and it's also less common in females and other male age groups. Many countries have not used Moderna vaccine in people under the age of 30, and a number of countries have delayed the second shot further away from the first to reduce the chance of myocarditis. Now, some have said that the risk of myocarditis for COVID-19 is actually greater than the risk of myocarditis from vaccination. But this is not true if you look at a large study from the UK or a large Nordic study, which I've reported on. There has been only a single prospective study, that means a study actually looking forward after vaccination, which was done in Thailand. Now, I read this study back in August of 2022, and I must say it's disappointing that we do not know more about myocarditis given the concerns regarding this were brought up just over a year and a half ago. It's important to let people know the risks of an intervention, especially if it's serious, even if the risks are very small or uncommon, so that people can balance the risk against the benefit and make an informed decision. The Thailand study has been peer-reviewed, and there's a link below to the study in the description. This flow chart shows what the investigators did. They enrolled 314 people into their study, and they did baseline blood work, cardiac enzymes, and echo prior to the vaccination, which was the original Pfizer vaccine in Thailand, and then they did it again day 3, day 7, and day 14 after the second Pfizer vaccine dose. And they studied participants in the 13 to 18 year old range, and 67% were male. Now, nobody died in the study, nobody required mechanical ventilation or drugs to keep their blood pressure up. Now, the main findings on this slide are that 7 individuals developed myocarditis, which means inflammation of the heart muscle, or pericarditis, which means inflammation around the lining around the heart. The 7 males were out of a total of 202 male subjects. No females developed myocarditis or pericarditis in this prospective study. Now, the first 3 patients on the slide here were people that actually presented to the hospital and were admitted, with one additional patient going to the ICU. These 3 cases were symptomatic cases. Patients 4 through 7 were people who developed subclinical myocarditis with abnormalities in their cardiac enzymes without another obvious explanation and without symptoms. So in total, 7 cases out of 202, which is 3.5%, or 3 symptomatic cases out of 202, which is 1.5%. Now, this is a lot higher than the number of symptomatic cases found in other studies that I mentioned at the beginning of the video. One might think that this is the case because the study's prospective going forward, so the young men and their parents knew exactly what the study was about. Thus, there may be people who simply do not attend the doctor or a hospital with symptoms of myocarditis, and so they're not actually counted in the incidence of myocarditis, which would obviously be much higher. This is obviously a very small study in Thailand, but it's disappointing that the vaccine manufacturers or other researchers have not evaluated this problem further to get a better sense of the scope of the disorder. The vaccine manufacturers are making billions on their vaccine, and the onus to me is clear on them that they need to prove safety when safety concerns are raised. The onus, of course, is also on governments to require the companies to do this in a timely fashion, which has not occurred in this case. It would not cost Pfizer or Moderna a lot of money to do a much larger study like the Thailand study, given that they're making billions of dollars annually. Now, on to the German autopsy study. At the University of Heidelberg, they found 35 cases of people with sudden death at home occurring within 20 days following SARS-CoV-2 vaccination. Now, in 10 of those cases, the autopsies revealed other causes of death. They looked at the remaining 25 bodies that were found unexpectedly dead at home, and they found 5 cases of likely or possible vaccine-related myocarditis with no other reason for their death. All of these people died within the first week of vaccination, with the average length of time 2.5 days post-vaccination. Now, of course, there were no blood tests, ECGs, imaging, or clinical findings because none of these people sought medical attention before they suddenly died. In one patient, a witness described a rattling breath shortly before discovering an absent pulse. In another person, they complained about nausea and were found dead soon thereafter. Resuscitation in that case was not successful. The other 3 people were simply found dead at home without any information about terminal symptoms. According to the available information, none of the deceased had previous COVID infection, and swabs taken for the COVID virus were negative at autopsy in these people. 4 people died after the first vaccination, and the remaining case was after the second one. There were 3 females and 5 males in this autopsy study. The average age was 58, with a range of 46 to 75 years of age, which is certainly older than what I've been talking about in the above studies. As on this slide, you can see the 5 cases, and in these 5 people, it's important to note that they found no other cause of death. The cardiac pathologist felt that 4 out of the 5 cases were definitive for myocarditis according to our standard Dallas myocarditis criteria. They felt that 3 out of the 5 were likely related to the vaccine, with 2 out of 5 being possibly related. The pathologist described their findings in the study, and in all 5 cases, the microscopic findings were the same. They did say that during the last 20 years of their autopsy service at the University Hospital in Heidelberg, that they did not observe comparable microscopic cardiac muscle inflammation or infiltration like these. This autopsy information in 5 patients allows physicians and, of course, pathologists to better understand situations where we may have a patient in the hospital that we choose to biopsy. This way, findings can be interpreted and correlated with what they found in this study. They summarize by saying that in these 5 patients, no other cause of death except myocarditis was identified, and hence myocarditis has to be considered the likely mechanism of death. They felt that the myocardial damage they were seeing in the cases were not sufficient to suggest that poor heart function was the terminal cause of death. And so most likely an abnormal heart rhythm, either a cardiac arrest with no electrical impulse, or another life-threatening rhythm had to be assumed as the mechanism, the immediate mechanism leading to the patient's death ultimately. Now, myocarditis-related acute cardiac arrest due to life-threatening rhythm disorders is a well-established mechanism in other cases or causes of acute myocarditis. Their summary is a very small number of patients, just 5, and it's obviously descriptive or observational. It gives no idea about the frequency of myocarditis from vaccination, and obviously, ultimately, it does not provide a direct causal link from vaccination to myocarditis. And I can't emphasize that enough. They finish by stating that considering that this adverse event, which is fatal, may affect healthy individuals such as registry and surveillance programs, they may improve early diagnosis, close monitoring, and treatment. If these deaths at home were secondary to vaccination, we of course may be missing some severe myocarditis cases in our studies. Not every death at home will have an autopsy. Now please note that this video is clearly not anti-vaccination. It's reviewing research into myocarditis, and vaccination has been helpful for people, particularly at high risk of a severe outcome, to prevent hospitalization and death. But with any intervention, it's important that we as physicians select the right people for the intervention, balancing the risks and benefits. And the risks, of course, need to be known. Certainly risks that are serious, even if very uncommon, need to be elucidated and understood. This allows physicians to have good risk-benefit discussion with patients so that patients can make an informed decision. As we go down the road and people receive more vaccines, more boosters, whether it be annually or what is recommended for people at high risk, we need to understand the benefit in that group as well as the risk. We also need to know what it is for different patient populations, because obviously the risk is going to be different if somebody's young and healthy versus older, as well as whether these people in question that you're talking to, whether they've recently had infection or how many infections that they have that might deliver some immunity to them each time they get reinfected. These are the sorts of things that we try to balance when we're making decisions on health care for people. Thanks for joining me today on Medicine with Dr. Moran. Get healthy and stay healthy.